Okay, fine. I'll just go there.
Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV in association with Bombay Spine Society Fellow Teaching Program. To introduce today's topic and the speakers, I hand over to Dr. Nikhil Arbati.
Yeah. Thank you, Neeraj. And yeah, so welcome to the Bombay Spine Society Fellows Teaching. We are back again after a break of 2-3 months. So looking at the lockdown situation and everyone has got time, I think we should utilize it to have the fellows involved. So today's topic, starting with it, will be lumbar degenerative listhesis. And we have a very exciting faculty with us. Dr. Aditya Kashikar is there, Abhay Nene sir is there. We have all the fellows who are there with their respective consultants, part of this teaching program. And to take it further, I'll just request Dr. Harshal to take it further. Harshal?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You can, Harshal, you can start.
Yeah, just give me a minute. I'm just sharing my screen, sir.
Okay.
Just a minute, sir. There's some issue with sharing screen.
Harshal, are you using Mac?
Yeah.
Then there will be a big issue. You'll have to restart your computer. Security settings. Somebody else can go ahead, or he's the only one presenting?
Yeah, he's the only one presenting, but what we can do is just discuss the problem, the problem status, that actually degenerative listhesis is the commonest presentation in most degen spines that come to us. Lumbar stenosis, come in with a hidden package of degen listhesis. And the decision making happens at multiple levels, right from the point of, whether they need surgery or not. And if they do they need fixation or not? And even imaging, we can get flummoxed on the imaging because we normally set our standards by MRI scans. But these are the guys who, the entire plan of treatment changes on its head by doing dynamic or standing x-rays. So right. It becomes a bit of a package that can pull the rug under your feet, and which is why we use that as the first, opening kind of topic for this, fellows teaching seminar, because you're going to see tons of them in every clinic, wherever you're attending spine clinics, and hence this topic. So Harshal is live now. Harshal, I'll hand this over to you.
Yes. So good evening to one and all. Today we have decided a topic of lumbar degenerative spondylolisthesis for BSS fellow teaching program. This is a very common clinical scenario in our clinical practice. And though it's common, but always the treatment options and decision-making is debatable and is always up for discussion. Let's see a few examples. We have a plethora of surgical options available because we're not going to go mainly to conservative because any case can be conserved. But surgical decision-making, we have a plethora of options starting from decompression alone, to fusion, to interbody fusion, to floating fusion, to hybrid fixations, to hybrid decompression plus fixations. So the decision making has become critical, and it's important for every fellow to understand. And there are some questions which always come to mind: that dynamic X-rays are they always essential? What are the radiological signs of instability? When a case comes to us, whether to conserve or to do manage surgically, and what is the current literature and what is the current evidence, whether to go for decompression or fusion, if fusion, to go for PLF or postlateral fusion or interbody fusion, what is the corridor we should use for different types of interbody fusion, and do metabolic diseases, inflammatory diseases have any bearing on a treatment plan? In a nutshell, lumbar spondylolisthesis is essentially a spinal instability. Every fellow must know all the classifications, right, from anatomical, etiopathological, the current concepts on spinopelvic and serratal balance, and also the SDSG classification. Clinical presentation essentially is mechanical low back pain or instability back pain associated with neurogenic claudication. Very rarely, patient can present with acute on chronic, like a radiculopathy with chronic claudication, and neurological involvement may or may not be there. essential workup we are all aware of, and the topic of discussion today is whether decision making between conservative surgery and various types of surgeries. Degenerative spondylolisthesis is a spectrum of a disease. It essentially begins with disc degeneration. Body tries to stabilize it. A body tries to get over it. There's a chance of instability while doing so, and also the chance of neurogenic compression. And the end of the spectrum is de novo scoliosis or degenerative scoliosis.
Yeah, the Jupiter or hospital.
Management, though it is varied, and decompression, fusion, and all other options of surgical treatments are available. And Dr. Subhanshu Baladhare from our unit is going to talk about a meta-analysis regarding this. He's done his MBBS from Nair Medical College, and he's done his PG from KEM, and is presently a ASSI associate with us. I'll hand it over to Subhanshu right now.
Good evening, sir. I'm just going to share my screen.
Until then, everyone please go on mute except the speaker.
Dr. Harshal, will you just stop?
I'll stop.
Nikhil, you have to go on mute, please.
Dr.
Nikhil Joshi, please go on mute.
Sorry.
Subhanshu, go ahead. We can see.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Subhanshu. I will be discussing today's topic of journal discussion in our BSS fellow teaching course. There are various treatment options available for grade 1 degenerative spondylolisthesis, however, which includes decompression alone or decompression with fusion with or without instrumentation. However, there is always a dilemma whether to fuse or not. I am quoting an article throughout this presentation, which is a meta-analysis by Scott King, decompression versus fusion for grade 1 degenerative spondylolisthesis. And we are going to discuss what this topic, what this article say about the treatment protocol. So why there is a need for this study? So according to Mayerding classification, grade 1 degenerative spondylolisthesis is a most common deformity. And what are the indications for surgery? As Dr. Harshal said, it might be due to the persistent back pain, leg pain, or neurogenic claudication pain, even after the non-operative conservative line of management. However, there is always a dilemma between choosing between a fusion surgery or a decompression alone. Since there are well-documented complications, including infection due to fusion with instrumentation or arthrodesis if only fusion are done, and with decompression alone, further long-term complication like instability. So the aim of the study is the meta-analysis by stratifying the patient into two groups, decompression alone and decompression with fusion, and to determine the difference in the clinical outcomes, complication, reoperation rate for patient undergoing surgical intervention. The materials and method include, it is a meta-analysis. Meta-analysis, as we know, in the level of incidence chart is the level type 2 of study. Hence, this article is one of the important articles. And as we discuss, you will come to know what are the benefits we are going to get from this. So for the analysis, the database include is from the Medline, Ovid, and MBES, and the timeline was dictated as January 2006 to December 2016. The keyword search was degenerative spondylolisthesis management. Total 531 studies were searched based on the keyword, out of which the 310 are differentiated on the basis of out of 310 was differentiated on the basis of operative management, and 56 were classified on the basis of only type 1 degenerative listhesis. However, with cross-referencing, we include some more studies and it comes to 80. With further criterias, like inclusion criterias, we only get 20 studies which are relevant to the article. And it was further classified into 13 study which are decompression alone and 12 study which are fusion alone. this is the study design they have mentioned in the article. The inclusion criteria was the grade 1 spondylolisthesis, cohort of at least 10 grade 1 degenerative spondylolisthesis, cohort of at least decompression surgery and decompression surgery with fusion. And there should be a minimum follow-up of 1 year. These are the 20 study which include both decompression and decompression with fusion. The parameters compared were the clinical outcome, VAS score for leg pain, back pain, SF30 score, Oxford Disability Index, JOA, back pain score, and numerical scale for leg pain and back pain. The complication rate and the reoperation rate. These are the result, the demographic result was in the decompression alone surgery, there were 591 patients, and decompression with fusion, there were 565. While the mean age was 66.4 in decompression alone and decompression with fusion, 60.6. While the mean follow-up in decompression was 83.5, the decompression with fusion was only 46.4 months. So while comparing the VAS score between decompression alone and decompression with fusion, we got to know that when we compared back pain between the two cohort, it was 5.3 in decompression alone before the surgery, while it is 7.9 in decompression with fusion, which after the surgery was 4.0, while in back pain with decompression alone, it went to 3.5. While the leg pain was 8.3 in decompression alone, while in the fusion, it was 7.5. which changes into 3.8 after the surgery, while the leg pain in the decompression alone is what 2.5. While the complication rate, the decompression surgery, there was only 5.8%, while in with fusion 8.3%. And it includes complications in decompression surgery on alone, infection only in one patient, worsening of radicular symptoms, and durotomy. While in the fusion category, there were 6 patients which are infected, worsening of radicular symptoms, and durotomy was same there. However, there are some other complications associated with fusion, permanent nerve damage, pulmonary complication, and subsidence of the cage. These are the forest plot showing the complication rate. As you can see, it is all included. All the complications rate in the decompression surgery are below 1.1. While in the fusion surgery, it is around 0.1. Reoperation rate in decompression surgery was 8.5%. Which is significant compared to decompression with fusion, which was 4.9%. However, the causes were recurrent stenosis, increased olisthy, and disc herniation in decompression, while the decompression with fusion, the causes were not given. These are the forest graph, which clearly shows that the decompression has slightly more reoperation rate compared to fusion rate. What were the limitations of the study? So the limitation of, since it is a meta-analysis, it compared all the study, and the limitation of all the studies are included in the analysis. There is a limitation due to different operative procedures with fusion, like micro decompression in case of a decompression alone compared to open, while in fusion surgery, TLIF, PLIF, and different PLF or simple fusion only without instrumentation. And there were different scales of outcome measurement as we have discussed with VAS score, ODI score, and SF36 score and numeric scale. The conclusion is, elderly patient with leg pain has a better outcomes when done decompression alone. Decompression has a less complication rate, and fusion has a less reoperation rate. Thank you.
That's very nicely read, Subhanshu, and you picked up the limitations very, very well. So for the benefit of those who have read this or not read this, I want to just come in and say a few things that meta-analysis is a very high level of evidence.
Yes, sir.
It's not as easy to do as you think it is, because there's a protocol that is given by the, you know, by some academy, which you need to follow to do a meta-analysis.
Correct.
However, when you read a meta-analysis and you tend to say, okay, global spine surgery meta-analysis, so whatever they say is going to be the final truth.
Yes,
it often is not. And you got to look deep into how the study went.
Yes,
and
sir.
There are some very significant, problems with this study.
Yeah, sir. I noticed that.
Yeah. if you see, if out of the 531 studies on the degenerative spondy, only 20 actually made the grade. Okay, yeah. So only 20 were actually studied in this meta-analysis. So you would think that they excluded all the bad studies, but that's not true. When you look deep, the studies that have been included are not included on the basis of their level of evidence. They're just studies that have compared grade one spondy. A lot of studies have, you know, not compared grade one spondy. So there are studies in which there's a 10 patient group. There are studies where there's a follow-up of, you know, as little as, 14 months post-op.
Yes, sir. Post-op.
Yeah, there are studies where, you know, the pain is purely rated on VAS score, which is such a poor rating system and such a subjective rating system. There are studies, 5 of the 13 studies that were checked for fusion. Yes, 5 sir. Of these studies only studied uninstrumented posterolateral fusion. Now, who does that in today's day and age?
Yes.
You know, so there are a lot of flaws in this meta-analysis, which makes the results skewed. And though the you know, at the end of the day, the VAS score for leg pain significantly improved with decompression, and the you know, the longer term reoperation rates of decompression surgery were higher. Like Subhanshu, you very rightly pointed out, the follow up of decompression surgeries was in the 5-year category.
Yes, sir.
6-year category. And in the follow-up of the fusion group was less than around 3-year category.
3 years category.
Yes, so, sir. I mean, that becomes a very, very big, you know, outlier or a big bias in the study. And, but I think the final conclusion is something that we love to believe, because that's what we all follow, is that patients who underwent only decompression tended to be older patients who had mainly leg pain. And patients who underwent fusion tended to be younger patients who had more back and leg pain. So in the end, after all this chase, it comes down to pretty much what most of your, you know, of the most of the fellow mentors have been following in their practice. Having said that, today, most of us tend to fuse if there's a listhesis and the pendulum is swinging the other way. But, you know, the reasons for that are more social than medical. And on the West, where they've been through this circle, they are now coming back to a circle because of insurance, putting the brakes on expenses of fusion surgery and the complications attached. And they're going back to decompression alone in even in North America. Yes. So that's my two bits on the study. Aditya or Nikhil or anyone else wants to add something, please be my guest. So Vanshu, thank you so much. If you want to say anything, please go ahead, and fellows are open to questions.
Sir, observation or comment related with this article is basically when they say for only decompression surgeries, complications are less, but reoperation rate is high, and vice versa with the fusion surgery. So in fusion surgery also, they have mentioned there are 6 cases where infections, post-op infections were there. So what was done for them? So usually infection, whether it was superficial, deep. So those details, maybe this is a meta-analysis, so they cannot go in details of each and everything. One can understand, but still, it's very hard to believe that fusion surgeries have less reoperation rate. They have not commented anything about adjacent segment disease, which we encounter in fusion surgeries. So I feel that part is missing in this study.
Fantastic. Anybody else? Any comments? Ayush?
Yeah. So again, one of the problems with meta-analysis is that sometimes the baseline characters are not compared. And again, this study doesn't talk anything about the baseline character of the two groups. They are not commented except for the age. And we know there could be multiple factors which can play a role in deciding the final outcome. So that again is a big limitation of the study. They have not commented or they have not said anything on comparing the baseline character of these two groups. So again, that is again puts the study, although it's a meta-analysis, in a group where it becomes slightly like the outcomes could be debatable, because we know we cannot compare apple to oranges, as we call it.
Yes.
So there are these PRISMA guidelines, which you all may be asked in, you know, if you're doing well in the exam, which are the guidelines given, you know, that preferred reporting items for systematic review and meta-analysis, PRISMA. If you follow those guidelines, then your meta-analysis is supposed to be good. But as you can see, there's such clear-cut flaws, and a meta-analysis can only be as good as the research that's done on the subject. And as you can see, the research done on this subject is doesn't seem to be equitable. There's a question about, does any of the study comment about dynamic versus stable listhesis? I think there was no such comment, and this is a very subjective view of, and I think Dr. Harshal, through his case, is going to bring this out, you know, this question of dynamic versus stable degen listhesis. Any other thoughts, Amit? Anyone else has any questions? Else we'll just break into the case discussion. Harshal, you can take over.
Yes, sir. So, Banshu, can you unchair?
It will be good if all the consultants are available for discussion now, because we are going to be presenting some contentious cases, and we want to see how how you feel about these cases.
Yeah, I think many of them are there, Abhay sir. So we can.
Yeah. I've made a whole list and given to Dr. Harshal on the private chat. So hopefully everyone will be included. Everyone, I can see Arvind, I can see Mazda. So please, everyone, if you're available, we want to hear. Dr. Vikas Gupta is here. We'd like to get your inputs for the benefit of all of us.
So we are done with the article discussion. We'll move on to cases. And I want this session to be more interactive. So I'll be picking some names, and we'll choose their brains for our fellows teaching. Aditya sir, first we'll start with you. This is the first case, an 80-year-old male presenting with neurogenic claudication of less than 10 minutes, having mechanical low back pain, chronic history, presently hypostasia alpha S1. He's been walking on marine lines 5 kilometers, 10 kilometers every day for past 40, 45 years, and he want to continue the same. His DEXA for his age is much better, 0.9. And he's underwent PTCA long back, but he's asymptomatic presently on regular treatment. And these are his images. Any comments from your end?
Okay, so what about the leg pain? Or he has only back pain, and the claudication part is because of back pain, he needs to stop. What is the status of leg pain?
There's more claudication than back pain.
Because of back pain, he needs to stop.
Claudication, mainly claudication, 10 minutes.
So back claudication, it's not much
leg
of a
claudication. Leg claudication.
Leg claudication, okay. So basically, and what about on examination point of view, range of movement, and how is
the
it?
Terminal extension catch, but rest all is normal. SLR is free, neuro is intact.
Okay. So he wants to go back to his walking, what he does daily on Marine Drive, 80-year-old. I will go ahead. Obviously, looking at the MRI picture, there is gross stenosis at 4-5 level with listhesis grade 1 degenerative on X-rays, MRIs. So definitely I will offer him surgery. Only now the question here will be whether to do only decompression or whether to fuse at the same time.
Yes.
So looking at his age, apart from walking, what is his general routine daily activity?
He's active. He has a shop at Churchgate and he goes every day.
Okay. So though he's 80-year-old, looking at his active daily lifestyle, I would be more inclined to do a fusion in this case. If same patient with more of a sedentary lifestyle, more at home, not doing much activity, maybe I would have done only decompression surgery. But looking at the active lifestyle, and patient is also demanding that he wants to go back to his active lifestyle. So looking at all these scenarios, definitely I'll be doing fusion one level TLIF maybe. And I think that should be my plan. So one level decompression plus fusion.
So first question for you, sir. What are your objective criteria, radiological criteria for fusion in this present case?
So fusion point of view, MRI shows his facets are quite full. So there is clear cut evidence that there is gross instability, which is depicted by that. And obviously, so basically the dynamic X-rays you have not shown over here. So I would like to see dynamic views as well. So if that shows gross instability, definitely that further confirms my fusion decision.
This is his dynamic view.
Yeah, there is gross instability. The flexion extension view, there is quite movement happening at L4-5 level. So I'll go ahead and do the fusion definitely in this.
Definitely.
So basically, I'll be taking two criteria here, that facet, full facets, and instability evident on dynamic x-rays.
And the demand.
And obviously, the clinical picture of back pain more than leg pain, and basically restricted range of movement. So all these factors taken into consideration.
My next question to is open to all. Whether the tall discs in this present case, L4-5, the disc is quite tall compared to what we expect in degenerative listasis. So is that a criteria for going interbody fusion for you, sir, Aditya, sir, or anyone else?
Nikhil, go ahead. Nikhil, unmute and speak.
Yeah. So if this patient would have been younger, the tall disc height is definitely a criteria for transforaminal lumbar interbody fusion. Now, considering this patient who is 80, though he's physiologically probably not 80, but still, fusion is a must because there is a instability which is evident on dynamic X-ray. But younger patient with tall disc height definitely would be requiring a transforaminal lumbar interbody fusion.
Why now, do you say that, Nikhil? Can you be more specific? Why does a younger patient with a tall disc need an interbody fusion? What is this tall disc business?
So, because the younger person will have more years of using the other disc spaces above and below the level which is involved. At the same time, I think that is the only
the chance of progression. The progression of listasis risk is more in younger
people. Yes.
Yes. Right, and restenosis due to settling of the disc.
Yes.
These are the two things that happen. Anyone in the house who will not fuse this guy, Dr. Dalvi, I can see you. Anyone in the house who will choose not to fuse in Dr. Nikhil Agarwal or yeah, Nikhil.
Well caught, Abhay.
Yes.
So I think Dr. Bojaj won't fuse this 100%, and I will be staying awake the previous night thinking, but I may end up not fusing. I mean, I will look at the patient. I will discuss with the patient the type of surgery and the pros and cons of each. And I don't think that if we don't fuse this patient, that we will get a bad result. So this is based on experience over the years that these patients, they don't do all that badly, even if you don't fuse them. They'll do quite well. They get completely relieved and they're very happy. And they don't have back pain either. So
pretty much what the article said. Dr. Dalvi, we want your, since you're here, and you're the only guy who says decompress, can you tell the house, what are the disadvantages of fuse and forget? Like, why not fuse and forget? And
fusion, whenever you are adding a surgery to, whenever you are adding a procedure to a surgery, you are adding its own sets of risks and complications. So you are now adding a further element of screw misplacement, screw cutout, infection, nerve root damage because of that, adjacent level. You are adding a group of set of complications to a procedure which is not there if you don't do the fusion. You understand?
Absolutely.
So, you know, I would also study this MRI well because he has shown only two sections, but I think a decision is always made by even seeing the patient, understanding the patient and discussing with the patient and seeing all the cuts. So now, although whatever he showed over there, that it looked as if there's fluid in the discs, but there's bound to be fluid in the discs. But those, fluid in the facets. But these facet joints, they were all not sagittal. They were like almost coronal. So if you can definitely do a good decompression without destabilizing this, especially the midline. And you know, the thing is that I have seen very good results. A, in my hands, yes, but I still may fuse this guy. But I need to quote our senior Dr. Bojraj. So I will see many of these patients coming and they actually do very well. So he decompresses many patients who I would definitely fuse. And though I am less of a fuser than most of you guys, but they still do well. So there is something, you know, you can't throw out the fact that you can only, that you can treat this patient with decompression alone. And 80 is definitely, see, if you look at the article, the landmark article on this in the CORR, 70 was given as the cutoff.
Yes.
Now this guy's 80. So even if he's 10, you know, and that was a 70-year-old American, that is Sengupta's article on American patients. So a 70-year-old American and an 80-year-old, he may be going to shop, but he's not going to play tennis and go to the Everest, which an 80-year-old American may still want to do. the biggest issue with correcting, there is a very deep concept which maybe, you know, for fellows, maybe a little beyond, but a degenerative listhesis is actually a protective phenomenon which is done to create a proper sagittal balance. So now, if you correct that degenerative listhesis, you actually throw the sagittal balance off, and then you force this patient to go into an adjacent level. So this is something very funny, that because this patient's sagittal balance is going off, the body gives it a degenerative listhesis at 4-5. So they are actually more stable with that listhetic position than with the reduced position.
So very, very
but
important.
But yes, I do take the theoretical arguments. There are two theoretical arguments to fuse this. One of them is a tall disc, and the other, I mean, there are no osteophytes which I can see on the X-ray at least. So one of them is tall disc, and the other thing there is, yeah, you can say that there is some movement on the flexion extension. Having said that, in spite of all of this, this patient will do well with a decompression alone. I'm very confident of it.
Dr. Dalvi, the most important part of what you said, let's not talk about this case, but all the benefits of not fusing are something that are being lost on the current generation. Yeah. And we just tend to feel that just fuse and forget what's going to happen, because we can put screws in 20 minutes. But you know that exponentially the complication rate increases, and you're undoing something that nature was trying to do. I think these are two big facts that you should be aware of, because you're opening a Pandora's box. Dr. Nikhil or Dr. Arvind, you, I think, strongly felt that you want to fuse. Anything you want to strongly say on this?
Yeah, so Abhay, see, we have a scoring system on degenerative spondylolisthesis. It's published in clinical spine surgery. And this is, almost a 10-year long study. The only fallacy of this study is we have not randomized patients to fusion and decompression. So what we saw was unstable based on that, or what we thought was stable based on that, we made a scoring system where all these factors were considered. Flexion extension x-rays, because surprisingly many a times you see this flexion extension x-rays being, you know, showing mobility, but these patients are elderly, they don't have back pain, they don't have facet effusion, their facets are coronal, and you don't want to fuse these patients. So again, this seen a lot of surprising findings when we decompress these patients, such patients, and even patients who had effusion like this, you know, they came for some other complaint later on, and you did a second MRI, it just settles, the facet, one facet settles on the other, and it just locks in. So having said that, so as I said, you'll have to randomize these patients similar looking patients into fusion and decompression. That is something which we didn't do. But based on our scoring system, this will go beyond 5.5, which is the threshold, because if there is facet effusion, there is mobility, there is mechanical back pain, this is a tall disc. So there are several factors. So in this elderly man, you don't want him to revise him again in case he comes back with instability, and it's a high demand back. He's active.
He doesn't have back pain.
Right. He has mechanical back pain.
Right.
Yeah.
So, your criteria for fusion here would be, can you just enumerate them, Arvind? Your specific criteria.
So, we have clinical factors. We have radiological factors. We have technical factors. So, mechanical back pain carries significant. This is a clinical factor, mechanical back pain. Age bar of 70. Activity level. Okay. These age and activity level is somewhere the surgeon has a scope of thinking about the social dynamics. So that leeway is given here. Then the radiological factors are flexion extension, x-rays. Again, more points given for a kyphosing situation than a translation, angulation. Angulation given more points. Then effusion, facet effusion, organization of his facet joints, alignment of his facets, whether sagittal or horizontal. The tall disc, Blumenthal et al., they said 6.5 millimeter, any disc which is more than 6.5 millimeter is a tall disc, but it varies from patient to patient. The same patient may be having all short discs above and below. So we have compared it with the adjoining disc, L3-4. So tall disc, more than 50% of the height of the adjacent disc. Then comes the technical feasibility of doing it. If the patient has very small facets, wherein you'll have to go from the midline and then decompress, you are excising the supraspinous ligament, infraspinous ligament. So that is an additional factor. These all add to the instability.
Got it. And Dr. Dalvi, Samir, can you give your very stringent criteria for fusion? in what situation would you definitely fuse? Are there some red flags in your book?
No. Like I said, if this same guy was 55, there is no doubt that I would fuse him. If he was 65, yes. If he was 75, I would think about it more. And if there is a little more instability than this, and if the facet is that sagittally placed full facet, this is not that classic full facet which you see, which is the one which is eroded and has given the instability. I would just like to mention one thing. Again, this is more of consultant level than fellow level, because it's, you know, sometimes these are concepts which you discuss and, you know, you should not teach. But I feel genuinely that back pain cannot be a criteria one way or the other, because I think back pain is not in our control. So even if a patient has back pain, it may not be because of that. And you definitely cannot say that you're curing or treating back pain by doing a fusion. So I leave back pain very much lower down in my decision-making matrix. I go more in with physiological and radiological measures.
Okay, superb. So I think this brought out a lot of fun. Does anyone else want to add anything, or Achal, you can take over?
Yes, sir. So as rightly mentioned, we were discussing about decompression alone versus fusion. Claudication, activity, osteoporosis, and radiological criteria were the decision-making points, and we finally ended up doing a posterolateral fusion for this case. Any comments about the X-ray, anyone?
Looks good. But why posterolateral, Harshal, any particular reason?
Sir, basically looking at the ATRN, it's not a gross instability, it's a subtle instability. So we went ahead and did a posterolateral fusion.
So the criteria being that not a gross instability.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Abhay, sir, what would you have done for this?
I think Ayush wants to say something. Ayush?
Just a small thing, although I'm a big proponent of fusion in this case, but another thing to look at is the sagittal balance. So you should, when you are, if you're doing a decompression, you will get away with it. But if you have planned a fusion, you have to make sure that you get the alignment right, and that you can do preoperatively.
Right.
See what is the mismatch, and so if you find a big mismatch there, you better be prepared to tackle it. So you can create, you can calculate it preoperatively, and if the mismatch is the PILL, the pelvic incidence and lumbar lateral mismatch is coming more than 10 or 15 degree, then you better add a cage. Make sure you have the good height. Make sure you do proper posterior releases, because if you have fused him with a bigger mismatch, as Dr. Dalvi was pointing, then maybe you will do worse than what you intended to achieve. So just a small point that
I think is a very important point. And in today's day and age, you know, when we are so aware of the angles, we should, definitely with one rider, which I must add, not to try and contradict what Ayush said, what he said is absolutely 100% right. But there's been a big, big fallacy about all the sagittal plane angles, that these are all young adult angles, and we should not necessarily apply them to older people who have a natural history of kyphosis. So if we try to pull a young old lady's back into a young person's lordosis going by those criteria, we end up falling flat on our face. So you have to balance it somewhere. We don't know the truth, but we seem to be going in full circle on that. There's a question, Harshal, why did you not choose an interbody fusion? So I can answer that on your behalf, because interbody fusion adds a whole new set of problems. So if decompression has that many complications, fusion has that many, interbody will add one more level. So PLF in today's day and age is our version of decompression alone. And, it's neither here nor there. It's like taking a soft stand on the instability. But I think in this specific case, the jury is still out, and anyone would choose what they would like to. Going forward, Harshal?
Yes, sir. Yeah. For the second case, I'll ask Ayush sir to contribute. 76-year-old female, mechanical low back pain, left more than right lower limb pain. Left pain is acute on chronic type, and leg is more symptomatic for her than back. For her also, neuro is intact, and her DEXA score is minus 4.2. And these are her images.
Definitely there is a component of stenosis, which is coming from L4-5 and a bit from L3-4 as well. And I think it is the leg pain which is the worst, not the back pain. Of course, we like to have a dynamic view as well. And another important thing which you have pointed out is -4.2. That is a big, big red flag when I'm deciding this case. So do you have any other like dynamic X-rays or standing X-rays, anything like that?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. So it looks like pretty stable. There is some amount of listhesis happening here. Again, like you see the patient as a whole. It is not just one thing which guides you whether you do a fusion or do you plan for a decompression. Now, considering the patient has more of a leg pain, more of a radicular symptom, more of a neurological claudication, -4.2 DEXA again is a very, very red flag sign for me to put any sort of screws in this patient. So most likely in my book, I will go, can you go back to the MRIs? So let's see. So definitely L4-5, I will decompress. Now L3-4 is sort of a in-between thing, which can generate some amount of discussion. So one way to do it is in these cases, what I will do is if the red is a classical radiculopathy, I'll try a bilateral L5 block, okay, and see how much it gives relief. It is giving great relief. They are doing well. I'll go only for L4-5 tubular decompression. But if the patient says that,
Wait, can I just intervene? Sorry.
Yeah.
So the thing is, sometimes, you know, the flexion extension X-ray may not demonstrate instability because the patient holds it tight. So you should compare it with the MRI, which is done in extension lying down. Here, if you see, there is a listhesis which is mobile. If you see the X-rays and the MRI. So you should go all the way till the intraoperative positioning of the patient to demonstrate this instability. Sometimes, you know, when you... position the patient, you will see that the listhesis is reducing significantly under anesthesia. That time your decision might change intraoperatively.
Yeah, I agree with that. But again,
so here if you see the next slide, you see that listhesis is hidden in your do a flexion extension, but become pronounced in an MRI.
Noted.
So that you may or may not fuse here, but that is, should keep it in your mind.
Yeah, I agree with it. So overall, seeing everything, putting everything together, patient symptom, age, DEXA, comorbidity, my plan will be to go for a decompression. I prefer tubular decompression. So it adds less to the instability. That's what we feel. And maybe L3-4, depending on how much I got relief from that block. And if patient still says, after blocks, they are symptomatic for then maybe add a L3-4 decompression as well. That is what I feel.
Sir, one question to Arvind, sir. Sir, in your case, I mean to say in this case, if you are doing the case, will you keep implant standby and will you counsel patient accordingly?
Based on this X-ray and the MRI, which I look out for, and the other thing is, you know, T1 MRI. If you see a T1 sagittal and if it shows a vacuum which is not seen on a T2.
Arshil, please go back and forth on the slides so we can keep seeing when Arvind is speaking.
In a T1 sagittal, you will not appreciate in T2. Sometimes see a vacuum sign is a black line which may not be seen on the X-ray also sometimes. It is hidden. So, I think this case, if he's an active patient, back pain is significant. He has effusion. Probably I'll be tending towards a fusion here anyways.
So you will counsel patient that I may fuse?
No, I will fuse.
Okay. So my question to house is, how many of you keep this fusion standby and you counsel patient accordingly that intra-op I'll see and then I'll decide, or prior only you decide only fusion or only decompression? How many of you do that?
So in these kind of a threshold cases, where I would have advised decompression mainly and there is a fair chance that it is going to move, In such cases, I'll have a discussion with the patient. But where it is really stiff L4, L5 listhesis, where a coronal facet, no effusion, elderly patient, no much mobility, there is decided preoperatively. Then there's no discussion of fusion.
So Arvind, while you're on it, may I ask you, since you're planning to fuse, what would your levels be here?
I'll do a L4-5 fusion. It looks more like a L4-5 here. This patient also is a right-sided leg pain, right?
Left more than right, sir.
Left more than right.
So one thing I should So one thing you should look for is also this L5S1 foramen on the right side. That is where you might get sometimes caught. You know, you should look for that foramen very carefully. There will be a hard disc there which will be pinching the right root. And it's very difficult to distinguish when the patient also has a L4-5-listasis.
Yeah. Dr. Rajiv Sharma from Ames has also said that, that there's a far lateral component on the right side on the at L5S1, which means that you may end up going far laterally on the L5S1. Mm-hmm. So are you still comfortable with a L4-5 fusion alone?
Yes, yes. I mean, if there is a component of, this one, compression at in the L5S1 foramen, I'll fuse L5S1 foramen, L5S1 also.
Right. And while you're on it, one more question, which I think Raj is asking, what is the white signal on the T2 SAG image in the disc space? What's your interpretation of that? We heard from you that a black signal on T1 is a vacuum, but what's white on T2?
Maybe there is some lytic element, degenerative listasis here or...
The disc space showing white. White is clearly bright and bright is fluid.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, this is mostly fluid in the vacuum sense. Yeah. It was on the X-ray. Harshal, next slide, please. X-ray shows a vacuum there.
Yes, sir.
So, if there's a vacuum, once again, if you, you know, float a fusion on top. Harshal, next slide, please.
He's doing it, sir. Just
it's yeah. Just... If there's a, if you float a fusion on top of a disc that's unstable, you could be found.
Yeah, yeah. So, there is listasis lower down.
Correct.
Which can't be. This looks like a degenerative listasis.
Correct. So, which is rare, isn't it? Degenerative listasis at L5S1. Yeah, yeah. But, so I guess Arvind, you're saying that you'll ultimately end up using 4-2-S1.
4-2-S1.
And Ayush, coming back to you because you are planning a decomp alone.
So for me, to at minus 4.5, looking at the patient, I think I can get away with the decompression as, alone. And if required, like I can undercut the facet, which is causing the and go up to far lateral. We use ultrasonic scalpels to undercut them safely using a claw. So I can take out as much as required to compress the contralateral side as well. And I, like considering everything, I'm not, it's okay if someone fuses it, Dr. Arvind can fuse it, but looking everything minus, DEXA at minus 4, 76 years, her symptom or more of it, like coming from the root and the and compression, I still think I will go with the
decompression. I'd like to get Dr. Akhil Tavri and Dr. Mazda Turel on the discussion. Please unmute yourselves. Akhil, what would your plan be in this scenario? It's quite a controversy. And Mazda, being a neurosurgeon, I think you may have a different take on this. Akhil, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there. So I would definitely lean towards fusion in this case. I think the instability is also contributing to some part of the leg pain. And I would definitely lean towards fusion for this. I'll not leave only at
the end. What the fusion levels would be 4-2-S1?
I will go for 4-2-S1, yes.
Right. Mazda, what about yourself?
Yeah, I tend to agree with Arvind's decision and the decision taken previously. I think there is all the indication to fuse from 4-2-S1.
Would you go a 2-level interbody, Mazda? Would it be a 1-level interbody or would it be all posterolateral? No.
I always tend to do an interbody wherever it's possible. So I would tend to do an interbody. I feel the fusion rates are much better. Again, I don't have much data on it myself, but whenever it's possible, I try and do an interbody. And in this patient, I would definitely try and do an interbody at both levels.
Fantastic. If anyone in the house has some different thoughts, especially about 2-level interbody, Dr. Arbati or someone.
Can I say something?
Yes, Sameer, of course. Rami. Of course.
Yeah. So this patient is going to be difficult and I'm going to again have a discussion with the patient and I'm going to say that there are some advantages to fusing you and there are some disadvantages to fusing you. And I will explain both to them. I will say I'm doing your operation for leg pain, not for back pain. And my aim is to improve your function. After explaining the differences and advantages of both the thing, if they ask me for my recommendation, then I will not fuse this. Because again, I think we will get away because I will not because will land you in more problems than the other. Because you like we said that you're going to have to do 4-5 and you're going to have to do 5-1 because that there's clearly instability with that fluid in L5S1, which means you're going to have to do L4-5S1, which is a 2-level fusion in a 70-year-old Indian person with osteoporosis. and your L3-4. So your reoperation issue will be that you will 100% land up with an L3-4 adjacent level in this patient in less than 5 years. So given this and that, I would say that, yes. So I will say that the chances of you having a reoperation and a restenosis and a re-problem are much less if you do a fusion, if you don't do a fusion, than if you do a fusion. And that is my recommendation.
Right. Amit, you feel the same. Amit.
Yes, sir. I feel the same. Like if you fuse last two mobile segments, the 3-4, which is already moderately stenosis, like it may go into severe, like as was sir said. I mean, then we have to see for 3-4 also.
Akhil, you have a counter to this because these are important messages and you've committed to a two-level interbody. So do you have a counter to what has been spoken so far? Akhil?
Yeah. So, I mean, it is not a simple problem, but I think probably I would still lean towards fusion. I would definitely advise the patient that there is a possibility that either ways you might have to go for a reoperation, but at least I will try to do what I think will benefit you more.
Abhay, I have a counter.
Yes.
One is nothing is 100% in spine. Okay, you cannot be an astrologer. So the thing is L3-4 is a short disc. The disc height and the vector is horizontal for it to slide down, unlike alpha S1 or L4-5. Okay. And even in case it develops, you can do a OLIF at L3-4 later on. The stenosis is not significant. The problem is the alpha S1 foramen. So alpha S1 foramen, it is an extra foraminal herniation. So these cannot be very well, you will not actually happy when you just decompress and leave them, especially when there is a listhesis happening there. We need to really, unlike a L4-5, L3-4 foramen, where you can open it. So alpha S1 foramen is very narrow. If you see the parasagittal views and blow it up, you will see that you just can't open it. You have to reconstruct it by putting a cage there. Only then you can open it. Okay. So there is a higher possibility of this patient not coming out of his original symptoms if you don't fuse.
Right. So I think these are very, very dramatically opposing views. And Harshal, do you have you want to temper this down before we move to the next case quickly?
Yes, sir. So we ended up doing depending on the age, activity, the demands, DEXA, symptoms were predominantly leg pain. And there were two levels or three levels. We ended up doing a L3 to S1 decompression for her. And now patient is 2 years follow-up with us and she's doing better.
Okay, so we've gotten away there. It does not mean that's the solution. Yes, quick retort from Ayush.
Yeah, so in my practice, I use blocks to define and select levels. I'm doing selective decompression. So again, there are three levels involved, but you can try like maybe a blocks for L4-5 and see how much they're improving. And again, maybe reduce the level of decompression or fusion here. Like not the fusion, because fusion is, we know if you have to do, we have to go all the way. Definitely for decompression. Just a small things from our experience.
Go ahead, Arshal. Can we? Because we are now really short of time. Maybe a couple more cases.
So this is for 59-year-old Parkinson's patient. I'll ask Nikhil sir to contribute. Patient is having
instability. Dr. Nikhil Arbati?
Nikhil Arbati, sir.
Okay.
So 59-year-old male Parkinson's patient, instability type low back pain, more than claudication. And bilateral low limb claudication, neuro is intact. And these are the images for him.
So he has more of a low back pain compared to claudication.
Yes. And he's tried blocks, he's done everything, not better.
But that L4-5, that's a disc, is it? On the right side, he doesn't have pain because of that.
So not significant leg pain. He's having claudicating pain, not radicular pain.
Okay. I mean, I actually am not able to appreciate the stenosis much on the axial scans. Not much of this thing, phleum and all. And you're saying it's more of a claudication. So I would want to have him properly. Okay, he's got an L4-5 grade 1 listhesis. The alpha S1 is, I think, mildly this. If his low back pain is not because of the Parkinson's, I mean, if it's not being contributed muscle stiffness because of that, then my option would be just to do a single level L4-5 MIST lift from the right hand side.
L4-5 MISLA from the right side.
I mean, I'll have to first speak with this patient that his Parkinsonism, since how long he's having it, how much are his symptoms of Parkinson, whether those are also contributing to his back pain and all. And if he feels that his claudication is also a worrisome factor as much as his back pain, then I think doing an L4-5 MISLA would be the option for him. I would not do anything for the L5-S1. Does not seem to be anything significant there. Maybe just have a look at the L5-S1 left-sided foramen area, but I don't think so. That's much of it.
Okay.
So one time decompression alone with fusion, you said.
Yeah, L4-5.
Any difference of opinion in the house? Dr. Aditya, Dr. Nikhil Joshi.
I would like to see this patient and clinically evaluate why he has come and what is his issue. See, Parkinson's patients are very, very difficult patients. Their entire neuromuscular balance is very, very critical. Now, to prescribe spine surgery in these patients is not easy. And the results-wise also, it's a big problem. Their fusion rates are low. Their satisfaction rates are less. To differentiate between issues because of Parkinsonism and spine is very, very difficult. So this patient who actually seems to have more of back pain rather than leg pain, I would like really think 100 times before even advising any surgery for this patient whatsoever. So yes, I would just pull on the patient really comes with a classic, because even when they come with what we feel is classic claudication, these can be symptoms because of Parkinsonism. So Parkinsonism, I have burnt my fingers, and I would want to caution you all also that don't be early in operating on patients with Parkinsonism.
That seems to resonate even in the house, because a lot of messages saying try medical management. But we are just jumping the gun and saying that medical management is done and this guy is like on your case to, fix this. Would you still refuse him or what? I mean,
if he's understood everything, Abhay sir, I think, and if he's a person who has understood his symptoms and he's been well informed, he's tried out conservative from one or two people, I think we should offer him an MISLA. But first thing, having a proper counseling is the must for these patients.
Yeah.
As Sam said, it's really difficult to get a complete relief from back pain, even if you do an MIST lift. I mean, if his claudication is also a worrisome thing, then MIST lift actually fusion with decompression works out.
Sure. Yes, Aditya.
Assuming he has all tried conservative management and it has failed, then definitely I would do decompression 4-5 with posterolateral fusion for this case, instrumented. And definitely L5-S1 left side also I will look into, because it looks stenotic. So for me, it's one level instrumented posterolateral fusion and decompression.
Any yes, Nikhil?
Yeah.
I will be doing only posterolateral fusion at 4-5 because L5-S1 appears to be shut down. There's no much movement on flexion extension views and no much stenosis on the axial cuts also. And the main complaint is instability back pain, which needs to be taken care of, and only posterolateral fusion can do that.
Asda, can I get you in again? Because there's a question in the house. Is Parkinson's, schizophrenia, depression, epilepsy a relative contraindication for spine surgery? Mazda, what is your take on that?
I think it's a very subjective thing, depending on the patient's level of activity. And rightly said, especially in patients with Parkinson's, because of their neuromuscular issue, depending on the degree of Parkinson's, we have to be very careful and analyze their sagittal balance before we think of doing surgery. One level fusions are more or less okay, but if we do bigger level fusions, they tend to have PJKs very often. Again, for depression and schizophrenia, you try as far as possible to avoid surgical options, because despite whatever you do, they're never happy. So if you've actually dealt with that aspect of their psyche, and you still feel that this definitely there is a clinical radiological significance associated with their symptoms, then one may go ahead and attempt surgery as the extreme last resort.
Yeah, I think very well said. The worst trap that you fall into is a schizophrenic with a foot drop, where you have to operate him, but he's going to be yours for life. And it becomes a real, real trouble, for all of us. Any other comments? Else we'll quickly move on to the next case, Harshal.
Yes, sir. So we ended up doing a L4-5 TLIF and L5-S1 postulateral fusion for him. He's on our back for last 1.5 years. This is the fourth case. Again, an elderly lady with elderly male, multiple level stenosis. Nikhil sir, you wanna, Nikhil Joshi sir, you wanna talk about him?
So, can you tell me the symptoms for one more time?
Predominantly mechanical low back pain and bilateral neurogenic claudication of long history.
Okay. Any deficit?
No deficit at present.
Okay. But progressive claudication, isn't
progressive
it?
Claudication.
Like, now getting disabled with the claudication.
Now see, in this patient, the flexion extension X-ray at L4-5 doesn't show any much movement. So it appears to be a stable listhesis at 4-5. The problem is at that same level at L4-5 and at the level of 2-3. So I think decompression, and there's a skip level which is now relatively looking normal in between. So I think in this case, decompression alone will be a good option rather than, and patient, as you said, it is a predominantly claudication, isn't it?
Yes.
So I think decompression will be the better choice as compared to fusion.
Would you have to do a discectomy, Nikhil, in this case? And if yes, would that make you want to fuse?
What is the age of the patient?
69.
Most of these cases are there. They are just annular bumps. And if you are doing a good wide laminectomy, we don't need to remove the disc as such.
Right. Anyone in the house has anything, any reservations about doing discectomies in listhesis which you're planning not to fuse? Like if you're planning not to fuse a listhesis, but you end up doing a discectomy, do you think that puts you in favor of fusing the back? Especially Dr. Dalvi, Dr. Kulkarni, do you all feel, or Ayush, do you feel strongly about?
Yeah, so if I see a disc bulge on the MRI, I look for any focal sequestration. You see a blister, if there is an annulus which is trying to come out. If it is ununiform and if it is, if there's a blister, annular blister, which is just waiting to pop out, I'll remove it. But if it is smooth, hard disc, or it's a calcified annulus, which is showing up on MRI and the patient has only claudication pain, I'll just decompress it.
So you believe that discectomy may cause further instability in a clinical
situation? Yeah. But at the same time, if you have a sequestrated disc, which you can, an ununiform annulus, which is just, thinned out the annulus, which is just trying to come in, waiting to pop out. If you leave it alone, that patient will come back, might come back, or may not get relieved totally.
Fantastic. Any other thoughts? Harshal, go ahead. We actually run over time, but we can quickly sum up this and put on one more case and then finish.
Yes, sir. This is one similar case, which was, I've got...
What did you do in the last one? What was your...
So we did decompression alone and we did not do discectomy or anything.
Okay, lovely.
Decompression both levels?
We did 3 laminectomy. We did not skip the middle lamina. So we did all 3 levels.
Right, go on. Maybe the last case now for because we really run over time.
Sir, again, a case of again low back pain and claudication with neurodeficit and significant retrolisthesis and advanced degeneration. Anyone would like to take it up?
One would have to worry whether there's some infection there also.
Exactly.
Probably doesn't change the plan at this point, but one may be worried. And other thing is, you need to see his bone density, because that upper end plate looks a bit funny.
Yes, sir.
But otherwise, if you just want me to comment on whatever information you've given, then I would say that he or she requires a fusion. Though that L5 looks very funny, actually. I don't know how, but anyway.
The thing is, Samir, that I agree that if there's end plate that are bright on T2, but what about the sclerosis on the X-ray? Yeah, doesn't that make you feel it's more degenerative than infective?
Yeah, I think it anyway doesn't change the plan. Even if it's infection, you have to, I mean, you if you find anything, you send a disc for culture and all of that.
Yeah. How about, just to pin you down there, how about if it was infection, you would do an interbody. If it is not, you would not. Is there any thought process on that?
No, I mean, if I do a fusion, my preferred choice is nowadays still interbody, actually. Because I believe that an interbody fusion, now here controversy, interbody fusion is less damaging to the physiology than a posterolateral fusion. Those people who feel that an interbody fusion is more damaging, they are not doing their posterolateral fusions properly. To do a posterolateral fusion properly, you have to really extend the incision up and down. You have to go to the tip of the transverse process. You have to expose the entire transverse process, abraded and put bone graft. It's a very destructive and bloody procedure and a lot of nerve damage. Instead of that, removing a facet and doing a TLIF is much quicker, faster, and less damaging to the muscles.
Are you worried about the cage being accommodated in this funny-looking disc space? Do you think the cage will get spit out or pull back or anything like that?
Not really. No, not really. I don't think so.
So standard TLIF is what you're gunning for in this case?
Yeah, I'll do a TLIF in this patient. I need to study more pictures because one may also be tempted to do a MIS TLIF, but in short, TLIF, yes.
Sure. That doesn't change. Anyone else on any thoughts on this?
So this case, I will definitely get a full standing X-ray because the again, if you see, there's almost no lordosis. It is like sort of a kyphosis in that area. So really need to prepare myself to the amount of cage, like the size of cage I want to do, or maybe if I want to consider something different. So definitely I would like to have a standing X-ray and see what is happening, because looking at this X-ray, it looks like the whole area is in a bit of regional kyphosis and there's no lordosis at all there. So that is one concern I have with this case. Definitely fusion, but then what to do will depend upon what we get in a standing X-ray.
Super, that's great. So Harshal, can you tell us what you did?
Yes, sir.
So interbody again.
Body fusion, yes.
Just while on the topic, how many of you all are heavily into titanium cages versus peak cages, or does anyone care at all? Does anyone feel strongly towards one or the other?
So I think most of us have started using titanium again.
Any reason why?
I think we have, with the peaks, we're having a little bit of more of a problem, and the fusion, even though I'm not getting good results with the peak cages in the long run with the MIS TLIFs. So I think I've started using the
titanium. From a fusion perspective, is it? Or from a displacement perspective?
From the fusion perspective.
And anything about tantalum cages, which are the new thing?
No,
anyone has any very hard thoughts on titanium versus peak? Okay, cool.
Abhay, I want to appreciate him for doing, placing this cage so well, perfect anterior half and absolutely bang on, in the AP.
To give a good lordosis.
Very well placed cage. Right. Otherwise, it is difficult to turn it 90 degrees.
Actually, I was going to say that I have some comments, but then my comment is that I'm happy he went to S1 because it does make sense to go to S1.
Why do you say that?
This is something which is intuitively coming out to me, that I think if you do only L4-5, this won't work. It's needed to go to S1.
Right, a longer lever arm.
I can't explain, yeah. And the other thing is...
If you think about it, because we want to know how you want to deconstruct your mind.
I know, I'll have to think about it. No, because I just think that this, the way this has got this retrolisthesis, and the way this disc is and the upper end plate of the body is, I think I'm better off going down to S1 and getting a longer construct.
Wonderful.
Yeah. But
the criticism is, I think the cage is too anterior. And I think his S1 screws, he has to try harder to converge. All his screws look like this only. So you please try harder to converge your S1 screws.
Right.
Was going to S1 an intraoperative decision? Or it is always thought about?
Preoperative planning, sir.
No, but if you had a good grip in L5, there's sclerotic bone, superior end plate. And your patient, so this one particular screw looks a bit inferior, there's L5.
Yeah.
It's not a criticism, just wanted to check.
I think here the surgeon thought process was that the L5 screws are going to turn out crap. and you got to get a good lever arm and go to S1 and give a good strong base, because this interbody space doesn't seem so great.
So any particular trick to turn it absolutely 90 degrees around, Abhay?
So for me, it is quite clear that I need the annulus to be intact, because that's the one on which the cage is going to slide. And I want to see the number on the cage after I hammer it. So it has to be hammered obliquely, make a lot of space on the side, put the cage from the side, don't skinch on the space on the, beyond the facets. So put it as obliquely as you can. And then at one point, flatten it down against the annulus, and that kind of sets the cage absolutely parallel to the anterior margin. I know you get some and you don't get some. Lovely. So a lot of controversy raised. Nikhil, Dr. Nikhil Arbati, you're the leader of the pack today. Harshal, you want to conclude quickly before you hand over to Nikhil?
So certain take-home message for fellows that always look for subtle signs of instability. Always look at the facets, arthropathy, effusion, the orientation of the facets, the sclerosis, cyst. The other signs of instability, which are apart from the translational instability, is modic changes at the end plate, the vacuum phenomena, discal cyst, and Bastrop's. All degenerative listases do not progress after laminectomy. We must be aware of the red flags and then decide upon which degenerative listases we want to fuse and which not to fuse. And when fusion is indicated, we must perform the surgery which works best in our hands. We were talking about the evidence currently regarding degenerative listases. Surgical management over conservative has level 1, level 2 evidence. Decompression versus fusion, still there is not good evidence and there are no clear recommendations, but level 3 are favoring towards fusion. Open versus MIS, level 2, level 3 evidence is favoring towards MIS. And with regards to interbody and PLF, level 2, level 3 evidence are there for favoring interbody. Thank you, sir.
Great, thank you. Nikhil, you can take over.
Yeah. So thank you, Harshal, for the take-home message. And I would like to thank all the panelists, especially Dr. Abhay sir, Aditya, and Arvind sir, Sam sir, and Ayush for all being part of this fellows teaching program. And for Dr. Sudhanshu for having the journal review. So we start again, and this has been a wonderful session about the lumbar degenerative listases, a very important topic for all the fellows. To start with your practice, and all this will be the most common cases that you will get. And it was very well elicited with all the cases, a very good discussion we have. And looking at the further topics, we are going to have next week high-grade spondylolisthesis. We will again have a very good faculty, fellows will be having the journal review. So thank you all for your cooperation, and would request again next week, Wednesday, 9 p.m. onwards. So thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bye, sir. Bye, Aditya. Bye, Arvind, sir. Bye, Ayush.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Bye. Good night.
Good night. Thanks.
What is the meaning of this reading? I mean, to understand the meaning, the way in which is the particles of the medium vibrate about the knee position. How? In the direction of propagation means how? SA, they will go. Not perpendicular to the direction of the sound of the wave. Anakaru? Anakaru?